Hey, good morning, everyone. I hope you like my Halloween costume. I came disguised as a nonviolence professor. I hope it fools you. In the meditation class this morning, I started off by saying, I see you're all disguised as separate individuals. That was for the meditators. So you're getting a sheet that's being passed around. There should be enough for everyone. I'll also send out a copy of it on CourseWeb, describing or at least listing some tips to how you can approach the question of writing a paper for us. And several people were asking me about all the books that I referred to, about the Jesus of history versus the Christ of faith movement. And so these are some of the main books that can get you started. This is the one that actually started it all off, and most of you got this on CourseWeb with some comments from me. Started the modern version of it anyway. Geza Vermish is a very, very distinguished Jewish scholar, a Hungarian origin, who wrote a book called Jesus the Jew back in the 80s when it was not common to remember that, in fact, he was Jewish. There's a joke about the Pope calling up the chief rabbi of Jerusalem and saying, "Rabbi, we've got some wonderful news for you. We've decided to canonize Einstein." And the rabbi says, "Well, that's nice." And the Pope says, "I'm not sure you quite appreciate it. This is the first time in history that the church has so honored a person who was born and died a Jew." And the rabbi says, "No, it isn't." So that was back in the days when we had still conveniently forgotten Jesus' Jewish origins. Geza Vermesh has also done a complete translation into English of the Dead Sea Scrolls documents, the ones that are long enough to translate. What I'd like to do is say a few words about the midterm, now that you had a chance to look at your copy of it. And then I'm actually going to talk a little bit about Islam, even though Camilla appears not to be here today. Right, Camilla? No, she's not here. And then get back to the question of the historical Jesus and what happened to the nonviolence that was at the heart of that original religion. And we're going to be, when we get around to that, we're going to be looking basically at three institutions. One is the state itself, because the state becomes the formalization at a very big scale of what was the community in stage two religions. And the minute you have a stage three religion, in my terms, that is, you have a person-centered religion, the state loses its absolute control over authority. Max Weber, among others, has said that the very definition of the state is that collective which has the monopoly on legitimate violence. That's how we define what a state is, consciously or unconsciously. And the second institution, of course, is scapegoating, which after ritual animal sacrifice has been more or less abolished, it goes underground and shows up in remarkable forms. And of course, war, which is not so subtle, easier to talk about. Okay, but I wanted to say a few things about the IDs first. Non-embarrassment was an embarrassment for us because it's a technical term and we meant it as such. And it really does, as such, it does not refer to the overriding principle, which admittedly is much more important, that the well-being of your opponent and of yourself, the well-being of everyone, intimately involves the dignity of that person. And so in principled nonviolence, you should never have to invoke any kind of mechanism that would compromise the dignity of the other. And you should never put up with a compromise to your own dignity. But of course, that can be a little bit different. You remember the story I told you about somebody who was slapped by a bully and wrote to Gandhi and said, "I felt ashamed, I felt humiliated. What should I have done?" And Gandhi said, if you felt humiliated, you should have hit him back. I don't care how big he was. But your problem was you should not have felt humiliated. Okay, so it's a little bit subtler when it involves yourself. But nothing in nonviolence should involve the compromise of the dignity of a person, whatever side they're on. That's a big issue, of course, and I'm glad that a lot of you remembered about it. But non-embarrassment is something much more specific. Who'd like to, someone who got all 4 points on that one, or who has learned their lesson since then, who'd like to succinctly tell us what non-embarrassment means as a nonviolent strategy? Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Julia is correct that it's a question of distraction. It should almost be more called non-distraction than non-embarrassment. It's embarrassment in the sense of encumbrance. And it's good if you're answering an ID like that to describe why that is important. Does anyone want to try that? Why does it matter so much not to take advantage of your opponent when they're distracted? Joy? Yeah, it's not the central issue. That's true. Sid?
Is that not given to their demand, not because they have a change of heart, just because they're forced into this awkward position?
Yeah, I think Sid's point is the basic one, that you always want, if at all possible. Now, obviously, sometimes there are constraints of time and you can't achieve this. But you always want the opponent to see the light. You want to talk them around. And what you're doing, if you take advantage of something like the English railroad workers' strike or World War II or little things like that, if you take advantage of the fact that your opponent is distracted by these, you're shifting the whole interaction from a conversation and a learning experience to a power struggle. Is that what you were going to say, Rami?
So your opponent doesn't gain understanding.
Right.
You can't have stable peace.
Right. So you may force your opponent into a position that's more comfortable for you, that you get rid of some of oppression in the short term, but they haven't really changed their mind and their thinking, so the problem is just going to come back up at some point down the road. So that's why non-embarrassment is closely related to no fresh issue. It's exactly the same point, the same reasoning behind it. You don't want the fresh issue to come up because it will, again, it'll shift things to a power struggle, and you may win in the short term, but you will not have improved the situation in the long haul. Okay. When you talk about something like the Harijan struggle or Champaran or even Chowri Chowra, sometimes you get into describing what it was and you forget to tell us what the outcome was. And I think it's kind of important. Like, if we ask you what was the epic fast, you want to tell us it's 1932, describe the issue, the separate electorate thing, why it was so important to Gandhi, and tell us that he succeeded, that he went head-to-head with Ambedkar. He said to Ambedkar, 5 years or my life. Ambedkar said, well, I guess it's your life then, because I'm not conceding on the 5 years. And the other Indians worked on Ambedkar around the clock till they got him around to a compromise position. So the thing worked. I think that's important to mention. With regard to Tolstoy, there is a very commonly held misbelief. I don't say myth because I used to teach myths and I like them, but I don't like lies. So it's a misbelief that Tolstoy and especially Thoreau influenced Gandhi significantly. And this is mostly held by people who do not understand that the Brahmanism or the background of Hindu religion was nonviolent from the get-go, and he didn't actually need any of these people. But Gandhi explicitly disavowed that Thoreau had influenced him. He said, I was really happy to see that he came up with the term civil disobedience. I borrowed that term from him. Similarly, he was thrilled to find that Tolstoy was a pacifist in the Christian fold, a respected intellectual living in the West. It was great to find a kindred spirit over there, But he didn't get pacifism from Tolstoy, and he didn't get civil disobedience from Thoreau. Okay, just to set the record straight. If you talk about Tolstoy Farm, which was one of the four ashramas, we consider it important to mention that there were others. That this, that in other words, this is a set, you know, the contextualization issue. And then it's awfully nice if you could go on to say that Tolstoy Farm and Phoenix Settlement were not explicitly called ashrams versus the ones in India, which were. And that's because it sort of shows Gandhi was signaling to his compatriots that he was coming out as a spiritual leader. He never wanted to be called that, and he always disavowed the term Mahatma. He says it cost him a lot of pain. But the fact is that he was letting people know by calling these communities ashrams that he was a spiritual teacher of some kind. The South African government and the struggles that Gandhi has with them, there's a now he didn't take off points for this, but his, just to get the record straight again, they were not British. You called Jan Christian Smuts British, he would probably arrange to have you disappeared at the next possible opportunity. They were Afrikaans, and they were Boers, and in fact, the last phase of Gandhi's South African career, if you remember, mostly is around him, and it takes place mostly in the Transvaal, and that was not a British colony at that time. Okay, let's see. Yeah, the fruits of action, this poem thing, it can be a little bit subtle because you want to say that you shouldn't be attached to the outcome, but you can't say that you shouldn't be concerned about the outcome. That would be ridiculous, obviously, for Gandhi to do everything that he did and then not be concerned whether India gets its independence or not. That would not make sense. Of course, he wants it to happen. But the difference is he is not clinging to it personally. He is more interested in his motivation and in the methods that he uses, and relatively less interested in the outcome. But especially the thing to avoid is to be motivated by personal benefit. That's really, if you wanted a single formula that would capture that concept in the Gita theory of action, that would be the one. You are not driven to the act by the personal benefit that you can accrue to you from that act. Okay? Any questions about this or the other stuff I've said so far? In the case of Abdul Ghaffar Khan, Seti, yeah. He did not. Or at least the name was not. It was not Tolstoy Ashram. It was Tolstoy Farm. And that's partly because it wasn't in India. But it's partly because I think he was stepping into his position in India. So you have Sabarmati Ashram and Satyagraha Ashram in India. Yeah. Most of you got pretty well what the power and the function of those communities were. Because there were several such functions. It doesn't really seem that it has been our destiny to see nonviolence played out on a very large scale yet. There are two quasi-exceptions to this, the realm of Ashoka in India and the Pennsylvania colony that we're going to be talking about probably on Thursday. But by and large, nonviolence is something that's been worked out on a small scale and as a model to be used for larger scale developments. So one of the most important things about those communities, call them ashrams or farms or what you will, is that you could do pure nonviolence there. And incidentally, I guess there's a fourth institution that I haven't mentioned that we could be thinking about in terms of looking at the degree of nonviolence in a Western society, and that is criminal justice. We'll be talking a good bit about it next semester in the B class. But you note that in the Phoenix Settlement, I think, there was an episode where some of the young people, teenagers, misbehaved. I don't know exactly what the misbehavior was, probably something absolutely shocking and terrible, like smoking a cigarette or something like that. And Gandhi felt that something had to be done about this, but he intuitively felt that punishment was ruled out in his community. In a nonviolent community, punishment is not used. So what could he do? What he did was he fasted to take on the harm and purify it in his own person. And in course of doing so, of course, those young people would see what they had done to him, and that would be much more powerful as a way of changing them than if he caused them to suffer physically or some other way on top of that. So in that little way also, he laid out a model for a way that society might be able to deal with criminal behavior without getting into this horrible, endless cycle, this trap that we've fallen into where we now have like 2 million people in the U.S. are part of the criminal justice system, one part of the cycle or another. Okay, so now about the essay, the only thing I want to add, I guess, is that if you do one of the historical questions, you know, take South Africa or take India, in the ones that I read, nobody really was able to put across that this thing had a rhythm, it built up slowly, and it had a climax and a denouement, if you will. So think about that when you go into the final exam. A good example for part of it is that famous little section that I quoted that you have in your reader from Satyagraha in South Africa, Gandhi's description of the 5 or 6 or 7 Satyagrahas that preceded the outbreak of the real freedom struggle in India. And he will show you that there was a steady progression. The confrontation was more intense with each one. So that's, again, it's like a conversation that's leading up to a big breakthrough. And I had a little breakthrough of my own over the weekend while I was talking to Jennifer, whom you met last week. And I realized that this is apropos of absolutely nothing, by the way, put your pens down. This is known as amusing Nagler, letting him share what he feels like sharing. It's not relevant to what we're immediately discussing. In a nonviolent confrontation, when you reach a climax like that, I suddenly saw that it's like there are two things are happening. You are shocking the opponent into a state of befuddlement, where the opponent comes at you with anger, fully expecting that you're going to respond with fear. When you don't respond with fear, he or she is startled. Okay, that's a golden moment. That bit of befuddlement where the person was exactly clear, totally wrong, but exactly clear about what's going on. I'm dominating this person with my anger. When that's broken up, there's a moment of openness there where you can introduce some other considerations into that person's mind. So it's like there's a two-phase thing going on. You're breaking up the person's mindset, and then you get to feed in a new one. This isn't something that's always going to work. In the story, I think it's James Farmer, who's being badly beaten in a prison somewhere in the South. We'll be getting to the civil rights movement probably next week. And throughout the whole time, he just kept talking to the police who were beating him. Finally, they said, the guy's crazy, and just threw him into a cell by himself. So it's not like you're going to always see the conversion there. But part of what you're doing is arresting that person in the sense that startling them out of their mindset so that you can bring in another one. Okay, so are there any questions else then about the midterm? Anything else we've covered so far? Okay, if not, let me talk a little bit about Islam and keep careful notes so that you can share them with Camilla when she gets back. She's our token Muslim. To sort of summarize at the beginning what I'm going to end up concluding with, we in the West often tend to think in polarized terms, and we think that our religion is a religion of peace, but Islam is a religion of violence. And there's absolutely no justification for a generalization like that. All of the major monotheistic faiths in the West, Judaism, Christianity, Islam, they all have the same dilemma. They start off wanting absolute peace, but then they have to confront the world and the situation that they're actually in, and they have to start making compromises. So what you find is glorious expressions of peace in the scriptural tradition, which in the case of Islam is twofold. I'll be talking about that in a minute. Buffered by various accommodations that happen in the real world. And if there's a difference at all, it's a matter of degree. And incidentally, the best book that I know of on nonviolence in Islam is by Muhammad Abu Nimer. Let me put that on here. Short for peace building, okay? Nonviolence and peace building in Islam. I've read a lot of books that claim that Islam is a religion of peace and nonviolence, and a lot of books that claim the opposite, and they're all wrong. And I think Muhammad Abu Nimer has a very good balanced approach. So first of all, what is the tradition? As you know, it arose in the 6th century when there was this prophetic figure, Muhammad al-Quraishi, Muhammad of the Quraysh clan, who had a set of revelations from God. And the word for God, and it's important to be aware of this, is al is the prefix the, and la means the Lord. So their name for God is Allah, the Lord. It's not like there's a person whose name is Allah, as opposed to a person named Jehovah or a person named Krishna or something else like that. So this is not a personal name, Allah. And he was in a cave on Mount Hidra and was seized by this incredible grip. It was like it was almost killing him. And he said he felt like he was going to die. And he heard a voice saying to him, Iqra, recite. And he said, what recite? What are you talking about? What am I supposed to recite? And these verses came to him, and this happened over several episodes, and I don't remember exactly how long the Quran is. But part of its power is that it's incredibly beautiful poetry, and apparently it's just about untranslatable. And these verses are called surahs, and so this is the main source of the tradition. This is a collection of surahs that were revealed to Muhammad over the period of his maturity. Mecca. Yeah. Joy? 7th century, yeah. You were born in the late 6th century, but this happened in the 7th. Muhammad, yeah. Not the boxer. Yeah. We're talking about the prophet. And so you have two major sources for the tradition. One is the Quran, or more accurately, Quran, which means the thing recited. And the other is a set of stories recollected about the prophet and his immediate disciples, and those are known as the hadith. So those are the two fundamental sources of Islamic tradition. And the fact is that there is no explicit and total rejection of war in the Quran, but there's a lot of hedging around war to limit it. It's an attempt to limit war so that most Islamic scholars feel that what you really come out with is a justification for defensive, limited war. Defensive meaning only when you've been attacked. Or, and here's where sort of it starts to get fuzzy, of course, like they always do, where other Muslims have been attacked or the innocent have been attacked. And it's limited in the sense that you always want to leave the opportunity for the defeated to be reconciled. You don't practice a war of annihilation. You don't, and they copied many prescriptions from the Jewish tradition also. You don't destroy fruit trees, oases, things like that. Probably they would have added libraries and museums. That would have gotten us in a lot of trouble in Iraq. So on the one hand, the one thing that's absolutely forbidden is an aggressive war against the innocent. That God hates that. We're told that over and over again. And when you wage war, when you have to wage war for your own protection or the protection of the innocent, it's to be done without transgressing limits, because as the Quran says, God hates the transgressor. Okay, so this is not a God of absolute love any more than the composite picture that you end up with in the Judeo-Christian tradition. But quite apart from the question of war, there are some surahs which establish nonviolent principles, whether they're applied to war or not. And probably one of the most famous is, this is 2:256, for those of you who rush out and consult your Quran. Therefore, listen not to the unbelievers, but strive against them with the utmost strenuousness with the Quran. In other words, with the book, not with the sword. And there was an expression in Jewish tradition, al-safed lo sofer, if the sword, then not the book, if the book, then not the sword. And there's a Quranic verse, that was 2552, this is 2:256. Let there be no compulsion in religion. In other words, you should not, according to the Quran itself, you should not convert anybody forcibly. Because religion does not work that way. And then there's another surah, which is apparently modeled on a verse from the Torah, which says, if you save one person, it is as though you saved the entire people. Now, why am I enthusiastic about that surah? Why is that important for us? John, you want to try a stab at it?
It sounds like person power, exactly, yeah. You remember, this is stage three.
The sanctity is in the individual. In stage three, you never say what Stalin said, apparently, one death is a tragedy, a million deaths is a statistic. You never say that. Each death is a tragedy, and the numbers are irrelevant. There's really no such thing as more infinities or bigger infinities. So once you, and the surah goes on to say, if you save one person, it's as though you have saved the entire people. If you kill one person, it's as though you have killed the entire people. So the germ of the person, the sanctity of the person, is there. Another surah that's very helpful for us. It starts, O insan, O man. This is Allah speaking to humanity. O man, I made you into tribes and nations that you might discover your unity with one another, not that you might despise one another. In other words, there is a confirmation of both diversity and unity. And that's exactly what we need for a nonviolent world. You want to be aware of unity, but not lose individual diversity. You cannot sacrifice Svadharma for Dharma. Okay? So in your view, this is very, very brief, but I just, because we've spoken about Judaism and about Christianity, I didn't want to leave Islam out, and also because this is critically important for us today, this non-clash of non-civilizations that's going on. Finally, there is one hadith that I like very much from this point of view. It seems that the Prophet, peace be upon him, was out riding one time with his companions, and he said, yes, if you are a good Muslim, you must help everyone. And they said, surely you don't mean that, right? You mean we must help a brother. We must help a victim. We must help an orphan. But you don't mean we must help an oppressor, because Islam is very, very against oppression. It's not to say that there are not oppressive states that are Muslim states, but again, it's this contrast between the ideal and the real, right? But no, the Prophet says, no, I meant what I said. After all, that's how I got to be a prophet, right? And you must help everyone, a brother or an oppressor. So then the befuddled companion says, how do you expect us to help an oppressor? And the Prophet says, by preventing him from oppressing. So that's very sophisticated, nonviolent logic, that you dislodge the British Raj in India partly because you need to for your own country and your own people and your own culture, but partly because they need it. And in fact, Kenneth Boulding, whom I've mentioned before as the author of Integrative Power and the other two kinds, he was an economist, and he did some studies showing that the British were ruining themselves economically by holding on to India, even economically, not to mention morally and all the rest of it. So you have this robust faith that there is such a thing as a win-win situation for every conflict, and your conflict with an oppressor is not against him, but against the oppression, and it's for his benefit as much as for your own. So with those elements, not that anybody kind of knitted them together and said, see, we have a complete nonviolence theory here, but all the elements were embedded in the tradition. So the rest just became a matter of compromising and practice. And in the 14th century, there was a saint whose name was Lala Aziza, who lived in Morocco. I'm just giving you one isolated episode to illustrate the power of nonviolence being recognized in the tradition. There was a general named Al-Hintati. You don't have to remember these names, but if you want to amuse your friends, especially your Muslim ones, I have all the facts here, who was engaged in the struggle to bring the whole of Morocco, southern Morocco, under his control, and he was going after region, and subduing them with his army in the traditional fashion where you force these subdued regions to pay you tribute and give you soldiers, and so you just get bigger and bigger and bigger, and pretty soon you have an ego like, was it Frog and Toad? You ever read Frog and Toad stories? So you remember that Frog and Toad story where Frog is giving a lecture and Toad is the only person in the audience, and Frog keeps saying, I'm so great. And every time he says something like that, Toad shoots back about five rows until finally he can hardly see him, and he gets it. And he says, no, you know, Toad, you're my friend, and I'm just an ordinary person. Every time he says that, Toad comes 10 rows closer. So it's really very simple, a way of get people to they don't see any end to the expansion of their egotism and their material conquests. And he reached this area called Sheikh Sawa, which is where she lived up in the mountains. And he's approaching Sheikh Sawa with 6,000 men to conquer it. And when his forces drew near the mountains, what should he meet but this lone woman without any weapons? She just came down out of the mountains and stood there, very much like that guy in Tiananmen Square, that old man standing in front of the column of tanks, and started to have a theological dispute with him and got him completely converted. He said, she is a wonder. She answered me before I could ask her anything. I have never witnessed a more penetrating proof than that which she used against me. and he was completely talked out of his conquest, turned his army around, and went back. Now, exactly a parallel story is told about Paris during the invasions of the Huns, when Saint Genevieve, when the city had no military power against them, she went out with her sisters and created what they called a wall of prayer. And the Huns, whom I don't even think were Christianized at that time, they confronted with this. You had this twofold phenomenon that I was just telling you about. They're shocked, and they see that there's some other kind of power operating in the world. They don't know what to do about it. They don't have anything to mobilize against it. And she is credited with saving Paris. Similarly, St. Clair against the Saracens, and so forth. So the history of Islam does contain episodes of nonviolence, just as the history of Judaism and the history of Christianity does. And it may be of special interest that in 1948, in Iraq, the British were maneuvering with their puppet Sultan in Iraq to take over the oil production. Tell me if this sounds familiar to you. And there was a popular nonviolent uprising. This time it's not religious. This time it's not a woman. This time it's not a single powerless person. It's more like people power. And they were very persistent, and they got the government out of power, and they got the British to have to back down. So just think how the history of our world might be different if somebody had remembered that, if they created a course called Pax 164AB, taught people how to do this, and after shock and awe had subsided, they could have delivered another kind of shock. We could be facing a very, very different world here today. Of course, you're already familiar with the story of Abdul Ghaffar Khan, but I wanted to say a hesitant word about the First Intifada, because this is more about Muslim society than about Islam, because in its first phase, the Intifada in Palestine they were proud to be a secular movement. It was a political struggle against Israeli occupation and various attacks. It was not a question of Islam against Judaism. I don't want to take the time now to go into the Intifada. Maybe we'll get a chance to talk about it next semester. But it was a very successful series of popular resistance movements coordinated by some people who had studied with Gene Sharp. Okay, so there I think that, to be fair, we've looked at Islam, and I think if you look at it closely, you see that really the situation is not qualitatively different from the situation in Judaism or Christianity. And if you were to ask me why there's always this problem of accommodation, why you have these texts and you have these wonderful statements, as we're going to see in a minute, by Christian church fathers, you have these wonderful statements saying, we don't get involved in war, we're Christians. And that lasts up until the point at which Christianity and the state become more or less identified, and then it becomes a practical impossibility. So you have the same issue. You have the ideal of non-war confronting the needs of defense and whatever other needs people think they have, and then the accommodations and the breakdowns start to happen. So I'm sure that the question on all of your minds is, how do we get out of this dilemma, right? Isn't that what you're all asking yourself? Of course it is. I have come to think that the problem is the negative approach. In other words, when we go into the issue saying, what are we forbidden to do, you will never come up with a practical solution. The practical solution will only be gained if you say, what power is available to us? Do you remember that wonderful anecdote that I told you at least twice about my friend Dan Ellsberg, that he had these Pentagon papers and those Xerox machines were right across the street, and what should he do with them? They were going to reveal the fact that there was all of this lying going on about the Vietnam War. He was the only person who was capable of revealing this to the American public. And he kept not being able to do it because the thing that came up in his mind was, what will happen to me if I do this? And then one day, something snapped, and I had nothing to do with it. I didn't even know Dan at that time. Something snapped, and instead of saying, what will happen to me if I do this, he said, suppose I were willing to go to jail. Then what could I do? And immediately became clear to him that as long as I'm willing to go to jail, they can't hold anything over me, and I can do whatever I want with these darn things. So he said, come on, Patricia, let's go. And they walked across the street and started Xeroxing it, and it was made public in the New York Times, the Washington Post, and so forth. So in a kind of parallel way, this is what I mean by the positive approach. If theologians and individuals, whoever they be, were to be thinking, what is nonviolence and what can we do with it? Eventually, you would work out a solution to the criminal justice problem, the defense problem, all the other problems. And the reason it keeps on being a problem is, as a kind of moral shorthand, instead of saying, let's work out what nonviolence is and how to use it, up until very recently, people have been saying the only way we can get people to change their behavior is by telling them what they cannot do and telling them what's going to happen to them if they do it. And that approach, I think, lands you constantly in these problems. So that's my second big insight that I want to share with you today. It's out of the shock thing and now this. All right, so let's get back to the story of the Christian West. I do want to emphasize again that what I was talking about the ancient world, and in the ancient world there was basically no such thing as atheism. I think I can say that without fear of contradiction. You ever seen that cartoon of a guy in a radio station and saying, and I think I can say without fear of contradiction, and somebody's about to hit him over the head with a chair? But I think I can really say without fear of contradiction that there was no such thing as a serious atheistic commitment in the ancient world. There was polytheistic, and then there was monotheistic, and stages in between. For example, let me mention another great scholar here. Very good guy, friend of mine, Peter Brock. Teaches at the University of Toronto, or Toronto as they call it out there, University of Toronto. he is the foremost scholar of pacifism in the West. So you can now talk about the war institution in particular. So pacifism, if you define it as the refusal to engage in war fighting, so it's a negative thing, not like the positive thing I was just talking about. He is a terrific historian, and he knows a lot of European languages, and has written just text after definitive text about the history of pacifism. And one of the things that he's shown is that the kind of pacifism that we're most familiar with didn't exist until early in the 20th century, namely humanistic or secular pacifism. When you had pacifism, for example, among socialists, of which there was a lot, their pacifism was that they were against capitalist wars. They felt that capitalism would inevitably lead to war, and they didn't want to fight in those damn wars because they didn't care whether German capitalists succeeded in trouncing French capitalists, a plague on both their houses. It's the workers that get sent off to get killed in these wars. But that was the extent, for the most part. Of course, there are always individuals who are different. But that was the extent of their pacifist commitment. So it was like selective objection, and it really does not do us a whole lot of good in and of itself to develop a nonviolent worldview. If you remember, even in the Bhagavad Gita, Arjuna is a selective pacifist, right? He is about to fight this war, and he sees his kinsmen on the other side kin bonds are very, very much stronger in his culture than they are in ours. And he says, I can't do this. And people are always surprised that Krishna tells him, you wimp, whatever is the Sanskrit word he uses for that. Get up off the floor of the chariot, stop blubbering, pick up your bow, and let's get back to work here. Now, how could Krishna, the Lord of Love, tell this warrior to get back into the fight? Because Arjuna's objection to the fight was he didn't like this war. And Gandhi was quick to point that out. That's not a legitimate position. You can't say, I have no objection to wars, but please only give me the ones that I like. It doesn't work that way. That you're always going to, they're always going to degenerate into ones that you don't like. Anyway, so not to confuse Arjuna's objection to the Mahabharata war as pacifism, and not to confuse socialist pacifism with nonviolence. It's a selective kind of objection. Okay, so an actual believer that war is wrong because human life is sacred. If you can, I guess you can still use that term in this context, and yet not being embedded in a religious tradition of some kind is a relatively modern phenomenon. Okay? So I have no objection to agnostic nonviolence in our century, but I'm talking about the ancient world. Okay. I also need to retract a very unkind word that I used last time, and I want to do this before the law of karma catches up with me. I said that St. Paul dehumanized Jesus, and I just said that to shock you, and apparently it worked, especially in some quarters. But as Eli pointed out to me, what's characteristic about the theology of Paul is that for him, Jesus is fully human on the one hand, and he's also infused fully by the divine on the other hand. And I got carried away and was rather anti-Pauline last time, and I'm sure that was wrong, and I'm sure that Christianity was of tremendous benefit to ancient Europe, and I'm sure that Paul's epistle on love is an incredibly wonderful and powerful document. I use it as a meditation passage myself. The point was not to speak limitingly or deprecatingly about what the way that Christianity cobbles together a set of texts and a set of beliefs over a period of 4 or 5 centuries in the West, but to say that today we don't have to be confined by that. For various features of modern society, what they decided in the Council of Trent in the 4th century doesn't have to be our Jesus. And we have an unusual opportunity in the last 20 years, it seems to me, to rediscover Jesus and then do whatever you want about it or with him. Because we believe in history, we don't know anything about history, but that doesn't prevent us from believing it. And because the scientific historical approach has shown us a Jesus who was much, much more nonviolent than we had realized. And let me quote you something from Crossan about that. If John or Jesus had led a violent military uprising, many of their followers would have been crucified along with them. Jesus's kingdom movement was instead a programmatically nonviolent resistance, but emphatically, it confronted present economic, social, and political realities. So apparently you had, with this movement, the configuration that I was describing in Gandhi's career, that he was against the abuses within his own community, and he was against the oppression of his community from above. And so you have lateral, downward-pointing, and upward-pointing nonviolence. And that's how you know that you're really dealing with the real thing. Okay, so what happens to this religion after Jesus is summarily removed from the scene, which happened very, very quickly, which was a catastrophe from which I don't think we've ever completely recovered. For about 300 years, there's this powerful wave of spirituality, and it includes nonviolent commitments. So, for example, you have the church fathers like Lactantius. He's now writing in the year 197 of the Common Era. And he says, "We who freeze at the thought of all worldly glory." You know, I don't want tenure, I don't want the Nobel Prize, I don't want a dream job, none of that stuff. "We who freeze at the thought of all worldly glory have no need for political factions. Nothing is more foreign to us than the state. For there is only one state that we recognize, and that consists of the entire world." So this was fairly typical of, here's another statement of his. "When God forbids killing, he is not only ordering us to avoid armed robbery, but he is forbidding what men regard as ethical. Thus, it is not right for a just man to serve in the army, since justice itself is his form of service." Let me read you one other thing here. This is from Oregon, who was one of my absolute total favorites. I probably, as far as ancient philosophy is concerned, putting Plato in a separate category, for me, it's Heraclitus in Oregon. They're my main man. Oregon said, "We Christians no longer take up the sword against nations, nor do we learn to make war anymore." He's obviously paraphrasing Micah. "Having become children of peace, for the sake of Jesus, who is our leader. And no one fights better for the king than we do." This is the important point. So the first important point to pull out of what Lactantius is saying is that if you're a Christian, you will not worship the state. And that's where the first round of accommodation and the first round of difficulties is coming. And the second important point is that it's not strictly a negative commitment. He's not saying, "We're not going to fight for you." He's saying, "We're fighting for you in a better way than you can possibly understand." I feel really good about it. I know when I was working for a Scottish doctor in New York, and I broke the news to him that I was a conscientious objector, because I actually wanted him to write a recommendation for me. He was deeply shocked. He said, "That means you're taking all of these benefits from society and you're not going to serve it at all." I said, "No, Jack, it's not like that." And we would have gotten into a long argument, except he was paying me and I had to wash test tubes. And that was the end of the argument. But this is extremely important to get a hold of the positive commitment, that we are a conscientious objector. And don't forget to go to the Combatants for Peace talk tonight. I know Yonatan, at least personally. He's a great guy, a terrific revelation. I'm sure his Palestinian counterpart is just as good. Once you step out of war fighting, there has to be some sense of what you're stepping into. Otherwise, the commitment will not be practicable. In fact, I've had this argument several times with friends in Japan, because, as you know, the Japanese constitution is not entirely their idea. It was partly our idea. We just finished bombing them, so we got to tell them what to write in their constitution. But still, it was a good idea. Article 9 of the Japanese constitution states, "Japan will not wage war outside of its own borders. We will not go outside the borders of Japan with military force." And now they're very unhappy because Japan is taking a tilt to the right. Duh, what else is new? And they are starting to reconsider Article 9, and you know what's going to happen when they're reconsidering it. So a lot of my Japanese friends are asking me about this, and what I told them was Article 9 was half of a commitment. You can say we're not going to wage war, and it's a very noble thing, and I'm entirely in favor of it, but the next clause has to be what you are in favor of. How are you going to defend Japan against something like China, something like North Korea, if you're not going to do it with weapons. Unless you see that, you will not be able to hold on to the negative. So this is what is slowly going to happen with the war commitment. And let's take the other institution that we're so fond of, scapegoating. Talk about a form that scapegoating took on, institutionalized, ritualized scapegoating in the Roman Empire. And everybody who has seen Conan the Barbarian or voted for the present governor of California, everybody knows that there was this institution in the Roman world called the gladiatorial combat. La gladiatio, it's called in French. And they call them games. Ludi. And it seems to have started in the 3rd century BC at the funeral of somebody called Brutus, not the famous Brutus, that three pairs of gladiators, the word gladiator means sword wielder, gladius, sword, gladiators, three pairs of gladiators were set to fight one another, sort of like a cockfight with people. And the crowd loved it. You have to remember, they hadn't invented television yet, so the only recourse they had was to do it with live people. And when you get to the time of Julius Caesar, who was assassinated in 44 BC, the thing had grown to this obscene spectacle where you could have 300 pairs of fighters killing each other, 600 men out there in the arena killing each other. Now, why does it keep getting so big? Because, if you ask me, and do you really have a choice? If you ask me, the reason it got so big was that the thing is inherently dissatisfying. And you know, there's part of you that's saying, whoa, you know, this is better than Hollywood 5-0 any day, and this is so exciting. I just love to see all that blood flowing all over the place. But there's a part of you which is not being made happy by this. And as Freud pointed out very well, you get into what's called a repetition compulsion. You just got to do it over and over again. The thing gets bigger and bigger. I mean, if ice cream were capable of making human beings happy, there would be one flavor of ice cream. And not 258 flavors, I think, at the last count. It's the same principle in a kind of grotesque application of the same principle. And as if this were not bad enough, the Emperor Trajan in the year 107 of our era, when he had a triumph, you know, it's a special state occasions like this, he had 5,000 pairs of gladiators. My combat is bigger than your combat. And there were shows going on in other towns of the Roman Empire, all outside of Italy, as we can tell from the amphitheaters. And it's a very, you know, if we had more time, I would go into the whole ritual with you. It's extremely fascinating. Anyone who's getting a PhD in anthropology should really study this, but I'm going to try and confine it to the part that's of interest for us. Well, who are you going to get to go in there and kill each other? Chiefly slaves and criminals. So you're starting to see an overlap here with the criminal justice system. And you actually see a statement by Cicero, who was asked, do you think that these gladiatorial games are good for the state? And he says, yes, I do. They are good for the state. They get rid of criminals. They amuse people, part of the bread and circuses kind of thing. But above all, and I don't think he was conscious of this, to quote René Girard, we have discovered at the heart of every religion the same single central event that generates its mythic significance and its ritual act. The action of a crowd as it turns on someone it adored yesterday and Mayador tomorrow, and transforms him into a scapegoat in order to secure by his death a period of peace for the community. So that is ultimately what the psychological function of these games is. Everybody is together in the audience practicing unanimous violence against the gladiators. And so many interesting things. But I'm going to just conclude with how this ended. Obviously, the Christians felt a little bit uncomfortable with this institution. It wasn't sort of exactly what they thought Jesus was about asking them to do. So they decided, you know, they wouldn't go there. And there's a very gripping story about St. Augustine. One of his students, his name is Alypius, he made a vow that he wasn't, this is, it would be probably around 300 AD. He made a vow, Alypius did, that he would not go to the games. It's just, you know, it's not a good thing for a philosopher to do. He was not quite a Christian at that point yet, Alypius wasn't, but his philosophical commitment was getting in that direction. And, but he's sitting around one night, and what do you know? The door bursts open, and in come the boys. And the boys say, "Hey, Lip, you know, there's this terrific gladiatorial contest going on there in town. We're way outside of Italy now. We're in North Africa." And Alypius says, no, sorry, I don't do that sort of thing anymore. You know, it's just not good. And they say, "Oh, man, you know, what a drag." And they start putting various kinds of social pressure on him. And he succumbs to an extent. And he says, all right, I'll come with you guys. But A, I'm not going to buy any popcorn because I'm a vegan. And and B, he says, I just made up that point. And B, I'm not going to watch. Okay? I'll keep you company, but I'll keep my eyes closed. They say, we don't care what you do with your eyes. Just come along. And they say, we feel good, because obviously they don't feel all that great themselves about going to the games. They want him to buy in so they will feel better, which isn't going to work. So then comes the really gripping story. He sits there. The fight is going on. And then comes a climactic moment. One gladiator kills the other. The crowd roars with obscene excitement and delight. And involuntarily, Alypius' eyes fly open. And then Augustine, with his poetic genius, says, "Then Alypius was more deeply wounded than he whose blood was ebbing out on the sands of the arena." Because he had lost control of his own will, violated his sense of self, and hurt him more psychologically than the poor guy who was bleeding to death. Okay, so this sets up our, have a question? No. This sets up our story. The gladiatorial games were finally forbidden under Emperor Honorius, who ruled from 393 to 423. They probably didn't completely disappear. They became CNN. They went underground in various ways. But now the famous story about how it happened. Apparently, this story is true. We have two accounts of it. There's no reason to think that anybody has made it up. They differ slightly in details, but ultimately, it's quite consistent. It concerns a monk, states here, whose name, at least in one version, was Telemachos. And as you might guess from the name, Telemachos, he is Greek. He's living in Cappadocia, in Asia Minor, part of what is today Turkey. And Telemachos must have been praying or something, and he hears the voice of God, always dangerous. Remember what happened to Gandhi. And the voice says to him, "Telemachos, Telemache," calls him in the vocative, "Telemachos, I want you to go to Rome and end the games." "You want me to what?" he said. "Yes, go to Rome, and these things are abomination in my sight. I want you to stop them. So Telemachus then proceeds to walk from Cappadocia to Rome, taking ships where there isn't any road. And he gets there just as a big game is going on. And he walks straight into the amphitheater. He doesn't even check in at the local Holiday Inn. He just walks right into the games, and these two men are facing off against one another. They didn't have very good security in those days. He walks right up to them, and he says, "Don't do this. It's not right." And they say, "You know, we kind of didn't like it ourselves." Thanks for that. That's a good excuse. Hell with this. No fighting anymore. Put their swords down and walk away. Okay, story is not over, unfortunately. At this point, the crowd was so frustrated that they stormed down onto the arena and they beat Telemachus to death. Okay, so I promise you there'll be a few stories in which nonviolence did not work. So far, this is one of them, but we're not finished yet. It turns out that Honorius himself was in the audience, and he was so revolted by the reaction on part of the people. You know, he thought it was this nice, controlled, ritualized violence, and when it broke out of control, he saw how ugly it really was. He immediately goes back up to his scriptorium, boots up one of his scribes, and writes a rescript or an order forbidding the games. So that's how it happened. It was if the story can be believed, and there's no reason to think it cannot be, it was an act of pure nonviolent sacrifice, which did not work in the sense that it wasn't too healthy for Telemachus, but it definitely worked in the sense that it accomplished the end, the aim that he was aiming at.
Huh? So work versus work.
Yeah. Though I wonder, because it did work. It got him killed, but God did not say, "Go and stop the games, and I will guarantee you that you won't get killed." It was just not part of the contract. You know, it's not like that famous conversation that Alan Arkin has with Peter Falk in a cafeteria in Midtown Manhattan, where he's trying to recruit him into the CIA. And he says, "But you have to stay alive. That's the key to the whole benefits program." It was not like that. There was no guarantee. It's like the death of Father Kolbeck in Auschwitz. He did not bargain to get saved. All he bargained to do was to sacrifice himself for another person and thereby to shock the Nazis to seeing what they were doing, and it apparently was brilliantly successful on that level. Now, this brings us to another interesting point, however, and that is the question of martyrdom. Is martyrdom violent or nonviolent? Now, there are those who think, I just read a quote recently that talking about 2 millennia of Jewish martyrdom, this commentator said nothing could be more pacifist than that, whether voluntary or not. That is not how we think about it in Pax 164. Intention and will have everything to do about it. Accidentally getting killed has nothing to do with sacrificing your life because you feel that you're in stage 3 of the curve, which Telemachus obviously was. You know, he's one person against an entire, enormous mass of desire to have these things go on. And he's intervening at a very late stage, because people are standing there with swords at one another's throats. You cannot expect, if you wait that long, to come out of it without some sacrifice. But, so there's this whole question of martyrdom, and there's an interesting ambiguity about it, which I don't think that we're going to be able to resolve. Certainly it was the case that, as Augustine pointed out, one of the things that led to the strength of Christianity was that the early Christians, when they were attacked, they did not fight back, but but they allowed themselves to be martyred. And, but there was at least one group, probably several, who were opposed to martyrdom, partly for the obvious reason that you and I are opposed to martyrdom. All those who would like to get martyred, stick your hands up, please. I thought so. But there's that obvious reason, but there's also another reason, that they did not want to be part of the system because they felt that martyrdom was scapegoating. And, you know, it was unanimous violence. So there were some Christian groups that the Donatists in North Africa and the Gnostics before them, who were, and they were hated by the other Christians, as you might imagine, because here the other Christians are getting themselves killed, and these people are wriggling out of it. You would tend to hate and despise them. But their reasoning was that you must not participate in the system, either as an executor, obviously, but also not as a victim. So they actually went partly underground and disguised their Christianity until the spasm of martyrdom, excuse me, had passed over. All right, well, now I want to get just around in the remaining few minutes to finish up the story that Eli touched upon, which is the Christian commitment to war fighting. In the year 295, in North Africa, there was a young man. He was 21 years old. His name was Maximilianus. And they came to induct him into the army. And he said, "Non possum malum facere, Christianus sum." I cannot do this evil thing. I am a Christian. And so he was immediately executed. And he has been proposed as the patron saint of conscientious objectors. So for about 300 years, Christians basically did not serve in the armies. And that worked fairly well because it was an all-volunteer army. There was a draft for the most part. There were these informal things that they tried to do to Maximilianus. But there came a time when the emperor's wars were getting bigger and bigger and they needed more troops, and especially more and more people were becoming Christian. And if none of the Christians would fight, you would have not enough men in your army, like what we're facing today in Iraq. And, you know, there's only so many prisons and shopping mall strips that you can go to and recruit people who are down and out to fill the ranks, and there comes a point where you just need more men. So the tension resolved itself in a remarkable event. We assume that this is more or less historical. There was a pending battle in the year 312 at the Milvian Bridge, where Constantine, who was the Western Emperor, was rallying forces against the Eastern branches of Christianity. And just before the battle, apparently by his own report, he had a dream in which he saw the cross, and it had this words that appeared somehow, which said, "In hoc signo vinces," which means, "Using this symbol, you will win, you will prevail." Now, the fact is that he probably didn't even convert to Christianity, but he immediately normalized Christian commitments and stopped the persecutions. There would be fitful persecutions briefly after that, but for the most part, the Roman persecution of Christians was over, and he paved the way for it to become the state religion. Now, once the religion is the same as the state, of course, what Lactantius says, you know, we don't recognize the state, that's why we don't kill, that's all over. So there's a rather, from our point of view, rather sickening turnaround, and within 100 years of this episode, you had to be a Christian in order to be in the Roman legions. And there are wonderful mythological stories that come along explaining how this commitment works. There's one tale, is called the Duodecim Legio Fulminata, the thunder-blasted 12th Legion, which was about a legion that was bivouacked in what is today Switzerland. And it was, the camp was struck by lightning, but nobody was hurt. And why was nobody hurt? Because all the soldiers were Christian. That proves that being a Christian will get you not killed, and which is the exact opposite of what happened 100 years before. It was like the best way to get killed in the Roman Empire, best and fastest. And so as some scholars say, the barbarians militarized Christianity because of their attacks on the Roman Empire and the need to defend it militarily. It became impossible in the 4th century for Christians not to fight. Okay, well, looking at that institution, war fighting, and the others, I think what I'll do is talk very briefly on Thursday about how rediscoveries and renewals kept happening, and come down rather quickly to the Quaker phenomenon in the 17th century. So here are your midterms, if you didn't get them last week. Were there enough copies of the sheet on how to write a paper? Anybody need copies of that? Okay, we have a few in the back.